another lot of people. So, good afternoon and welcome to St Mary's Perivale in West London. We've got a keen audience here for a special afternoon. We have a lecture by Tasmin Little entitled Old Pastures and New Paths. Now, most music lovers won't need any introduction to Tasmin Little. She's a world-famous violinist, has been for about 30 years, and is one of the best going. Anyway, she decided to put her violin down, as it were, metaphorically speaking, about 2 years ago to do other things, hence the title of the lecture. But she's going to talk all about her life and career. I can't wait. Tasmin is a local lady. She's lived in Ealing for decades, and so it's a particular pleasure to have her and some of her family and friends here along for this very special afternoon. So without more ado, I'm going to ask the audience to put their hands together to give a warm welcome.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and potentially good evening, and maybe even good morning to anybody currently listening from overseas. I'm really happy to be here in this beautiful old church. It's actually my debut in this church, so I'm very, very pleased to be here. And over the next hour or so, I'd like to share some experiences in my life and talk to you a little bit about the wonderful people that I met during the course of my career and the people that I continue to meet in this new part of my career. But I think we'll just kick off, first of all, with something that's really from my childhood. My father, George Little, was an actor, and he was in many musicals, and I grew up with a lot of music in the house of all different varieties. But I think we're going to launch in with something from Fiddler on the Roof, which my father was in, both in the stage production as well as the film. So, George, take it away.
Today's a wolf to come here to title your daughter
my wife.
May all your futures be pleasant ones, not like our present ones. Bring L'chaim to life, L'chaim.
L'chaim.
L'chaim, L'chaim to life. It takes a wedding to make a save. Let's live another day.
Drink L'chaim to life.
We'll raise a glass and sip a drop of schnapps in honor of the great good luck that favored you. We know that when good fortune favors to such men, it stands to reason we deserve it too. To us and our good fortune,
be happy, be healthy, long life.
And if our good fortune ever comes, kiss to whatever comes.
Drink L'chaim to life.
Thank you.
I thought that that would be a great way to start. When my father was on tour when I was about six, I was ill with chickenpox, and I was very bored at home, and I hit upon the idea that it would be nice to play the recorder. So I asked my mum if she'd very kindly buy me a recorder, and I proceeded to teach myself to read the treble clef and then to play, and I got better. And I wanted to play the piano, and I wanted to play the violin. And after a bit of a kerfuffle, because I was too young to start the violin according to the state school system, but anyway, the violin teacher at my state primary school gave me an ear test and said to my mother that I was very musical, and he would move the mountains so that I could begin. And after just about a year or so, he said that I had made such good progress that soon he wouldn't be able to teach me, and that it was very important that I went to a specialist music school. So there were various possibilities on the list, but he wanted me to try for the Yehudi Menuhin School. I missed the initial audition because it was too late. It had been early in the September and it was March, but the school kindly agreed to give me two auditions in one day. I could do my preliminary in the morning, and then if I achieved that, I could go in the afternoon and play for everybody, including Yehudi Menuhin. It's very lucky sometimes that you just have no idea when you're seven exactly what you're doing, because I think, you know, had I known that there were 300 applicants for eight places, and I've been learning a year, and also I heard other people warming up and they sounded so much better than I did. So anyway, I went, I enjoyed the audition. There were a lot of terribly old people there, but they were very nice to me. And anyway, to cut a long story short, I got into the school, and that was where I spent the next 10 years of my life. It was a boarding school. It was a heavy schedule for an eight-year-old. You got up at 6:30 in the morning, and you did classes before breakfast from 7 until 8. And then you carried on, and half the school, which was a small school in those days, 35 students only. I was in a class of three because I was only eight. And so anyway, half the school would do music and the other half would do academic, and then we'd swap around. So we obviously had to do the full national curriculum. That was very, very important. But we managed to get everything done by having very long days, and sometimes there were concerts in the evening as well. But it was a fantastic thing to be immersed in all this music, and very inspiring as well for me to hear and see the older students who'd been through the system, if you like, people like Nigel Kennedy, who was, you know, playing marvellously. And I just thought, wow, I'm in a school that gives me this possibility to be connected to brilliant young musicians. So it was a great environment, and I thrived. And of course, highlights were about three times a year, Yehudi Menuhin would come and he would hear all of us. And I remember very initially, my teacher was worried about various things, so she'd given me a couple of exercises to do, and that was it. So Yehudi was very kind, you know, and he went, "Well then, Tasmin, what are you going to do?" And I said, he was Mr. Menuhin in those days. And I said, "Well, Mr. Menuhin, the only thing that I'm doing at the moment are these two exercises." And I diligently showed him my two exercises. But he was just so lovely. And I never in my whole time that I knew him, I never saw or heard him raise his voice or get angry. He was just a very modest, quietly spoken, humble human being, very, very inspiring and a real humanitarian. And obviously towards the end of his life, he went on to do great things politically and used his position in the House of Lords for the greater good. So he continues to inspire me even to this day. And one of the things that I did early on in my new life was to make a program, a Radio 4 program called Great Lives with Matthew Paris. And I chose Yehudi Menuhin as my subject. And actually I learned a lot, because Humphrey Burton, who was his biographer, he had marvelous stories to tell. And so it was Humphrey, Matthew, and and me. And so I think it would be lovely to pay tribute and listen to a very early recording of Yehudi Menuhin playing Dvorak's Songs My Mother Taught Me. This is in an arrangement by Louis Persinger, who was one of his teachers. And it's so, I find it so moving to listen to this because the microphone is very close, so you can hear him breathing, and I can just really get the feeling of how he's playing it. It's touching, really moving. Thanks, George. I think everybody knows that playing a musical instrument to a high standard requires literally years of hard work, discipline, practice, day in, day out. But I think not everybody realizes how hard it is on the parents as well. It's not just the sort of taking your child to music lessons and making sure that, you know, they do their practice. But if they get good, there is the eternal problem of an instrument that needs to be solved, and it's not easy. I was very lucky. My parents were amazingly supportive, and I did fundraising concerts with my father to raise enough money to buy my first instrument, Henry Lockie Hill. It was a beautiful instrument, and I made some of my very earliest recordings, but more of that in a moment. So after my stint at the Menuhin School, I went to do 3 years of study at the Guildhall School of Music, which I thoroughly enjoyed, ended up in my third year winning the big prize, which is called the Gold Medal. But by that time, I felt that I needed to spread my wings and to go abroad to study. And I had met at a summer school, I had met this wonderful Hungarian teacher called Laurent Fenevesh. And I decided I wanted to go and study with him privately in Toronto for a winter. What a stupid idea that was. Goodness me, why didn't I choose a different time of year? Anyway, so I then had to raise enough money to go and study for 7 or 8 months in Canada because I couldn't work out there, so I had to take all my money with me. So I had to get the airfare, I had to have all my money for my tuition fees from Mr. Fenevesh, of course, rent for housing and food and any travel costs, etc. So the bill came to £6,500, which is what I had to raise in 1985 to 86. And I did lots of different funds. But it wasn't easy because lots of trusts would give you money if you were going to go to an institution. But I didn't want to go to an institution. I'd been at institutions for 13 years. I wanted to go and study privately and just get lots of work done. So there weren't very many funds that I could apply to. There were four. And I had done all three of the four. And unfortunately, I was still £3,000 short of the amount that I needed. And I'd got one more to do, and it was called the Countess of Munster. It's still going to this day. So anyway, I knew that even if they gave me the maximum, and they only awarded two maximum prizes of, I think it was 2,500. So even if they gave me the maximum, I was going to be 500 short, but that was, even if I got the most that they were going to allocate, and they didn't, you know, there were lots of little prizes of 500. Anyway, blow me down. I'm normally a very, very organized person, but when I looked at my notes to see the pieces of music that I had put down back in the September for my audition, I suddenly realized that I had forgotten entirely that I put a brand new piece in. And not only that, it was a really difficult piece, a piece by Sarasate called Zapateado. And it's one of those ferocious things. It's so, so fast. If you've never heard it, go back home, put in YouTube, Heifetz Zapateado, and you'll know what I mean. Anyway, I'd put down that I was going to do a piece of Bach. That was great. I knew that. But I had 1 week to learn this piece. And I said to my teacher, Pawnee, I said, I've really blown it. I totally forgot, 9 months ago, I said I was going to do this. And she said, you've got a week. Let's see how much we can do. So I worked and I worked and I worked. And it was coming. And I did my second lesson with Pauline. And she said, it's up to you. You could just about get away with it if you play well. So I thought, I've always been quite courageous, actually, and I like a challenge. So I decided I was going to do it, even though my life depended on it. I'd never played it with piano, and I'd had the official pianist that you meet about 5 minutes before you go and you do this audition. And the other thing was that most of the other auditions, it had been a panel of about three people. Well, I walked in, and there were 10 of them in a row. And my heart was going very fast indeed. Anyway, I played the Bach, and that went well. And then I took a deep breath, and I played the Zapateado. And it probably was about the best that I played it. But then that's not all. Then you sit in front of this panel, and you're grilled for 20 minutes. And they ask you, why do you need this? And break down this budget and everything. But I'd really been organized about that and explained how much everything was and showed them the balance sheet, as it were. And so they asked me loads of questions. And then they looked around at the end, anybody got any other questions? Everybody's shaking their head. No, no, no. And I think I'm about to be let go. But then Jack Brimer, the wonderful clarinetist who I encountered later on in my career, Jack Brimer, bless him, he said, "So, Tasmin," and I said, "Yes, Mr. Brimer, how long have you been learning that Zapateado?" So now I have a dilemma. Do I lie and risk them thinking that, it should be better by now? Or do I tell the truth and risk them thinking, gosh, she's a bit cavalier, learning this piece in a week? Well, I am a very honest person. It had to be the truth. So I looked at him and I said, a week. And he looked straight back at me, and the corners of his mouth twitched. But he kept a straight face, and all he said was, "Bit of a risk, wasn't it?" And I said, "Yup." And he said, "Okay, you can go." Oh, ladies and gentlemen, they gave me all of the money that I needed. And I really, to this day, I think it was because Jack Brimer said to them after I'd gone, "If she can learn that piece in a week, she can do all of the things that she needs to do in Canada." So anyway, that was terrific. So off I went to freezing Toronto and had the most brilliant time. Learning with Mr. Fenevesh, I learned 6 concertos, 6 huge sonatas, including the Beethoven Kreutzer, and 6 big pieces. So I came back and felt very pleased about how well I'd done. Oh, and Mr. Fenevesh was a gem, and he wrote me a marvelous reference and said, "And she's been eating a concerto a week, and she's learned all of this." And so I was able to write to the Countess of Munster and say, "I ticked every box, and thank you again for the money." So that was a very happy ending, thank goodness. So then, of course, there's this moment. You've been studying your instrument for 14 years. Your parents have laid out a fortune. You've raised money to go and study in Canada. You can't pretend to be a student anymore, and somehow or other, you have to begin this career. I'd done well in the BBC Young Musician of the Year, so I had small concerts that came in, and I also did very well in the first Uni Minuan International competition, which had given me an entree into the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, and they gave me some early concerts, which was great. But it was, you know, still very early days, and I thought to myself, okay, I'll give myself 3 or 4 years, and then I have to think of a plan B, because I really wanted to be a soloist. But, you know, it's a difficult path. Lots of people want to be soloists, and not everybody can take that spot. So anyway, so a couple of good things happened. Through the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, I got to meet a marvelous German conductor, Kurt Mazur. And they asked me to play the Delius Violin Concerto, which was terrific. I showed up at Leeds Town Hall, met Mr. Mazur in the dressing room, and he was another amazingly humble person. The greatest musicians are very often the most humble people. The ones who throw their toys out of the cradle are generally the ones who aren't quite so good. Anyway, he said, "I don't know this Delius. You must teach it to me." I mean, I was 21, and he was a great and respected conductor. Anyway, we had a marvelous collaboration, and that concert went very well. And after I'd come off stage, it was the interval, and he said, come into my dressing room. He said, "Play me the cadenza of the Brahms Violin Concerto." Okay, luckily I'd learnt it and I knew it, but I wasn't expecting that. But anyway, I played it, and he said, "Good." He said, "You will hear from me. You will hear." So that was that, so excellent. And then that was just before I went to study in Toronto. I came back from Toronto to find that I had this, I'm so sorry, I'm wrong about this. It was before I went to Toronto, but he then invited me to play in Leipzig just before I went to study with Mr. Fenevesh. That was it, it was shortly afterwards. So I actually gave the Leipzig premiere of the Delius Violin Concerto in autumn 1986. And I actually went through Checkpoint Charlie, which was an extraordinary experience. I'm glad I did it now, but it was scary because you're walking along this sort of no man's land, and it says you're now leaving the American sector and everything. So there I was walking, and then you go inside this very dingy sort of office-y kind of place. And the first thing you've got to do is you have to go into this glass cubicle, which is locked either side. And you've got Rosa Klebb from James Bond looking at you, and very, very stern with very scraped back hair. And she grilled me, but of course I had the trump card, Kurt Mazur, who was God in East Germany and very respected. Of course I had papers, Mr. Mazur invites Miss Tasmin Little. So that was okay. So anyway, got out the other side and really enjoyed it. Then went off to Canada, by which time he'd invited me again to do a tour of East Germany. And I was there for 2 weeks, and it was in early December. My route was different. This time I wasn't going through Checkpoint Charlie. I was flying to Copenhagen, and from Copenhagen I was taking an East German airline directly to East Berlin. Well, I made it, but my suitcase didn't. And so there I was in cold East Germany with just the clothes that I was standing up in and my violin. But I had no concert dress, and my first concert was the next day. And the first thing that happened was that I was taken off to Schwerin to the Mecklenburgischen Staatskapelle, which was the theatre there, the opera house, and rehearsed, but didn't know what I was going to stand on stage in. But of course, what does any self-respecting opera house have, particularly in Germany? A costume department. So after my rehearsal, I was taken off to the costume department. All the costumes were very, very large to cater for the extremely ample Russian sopranos. I was not quite so large, but they found me quite a fetching dress. It was a bit long and it needed bringing in, but of course, what's the other thing that a costume department has? Seamstresses galore. I was pinned and tucked and everything, and this dress fitted me like a glove by the end of it. I borrowed a member of the orchestra's strappy summer sandals and a pair of tights. And that was how I walked on stage to make my debut. And I'm very happy to tell you my suitcase turned up the next day. So that was all good. But one of the things, because people often say, what do you need as a soloist? There's many things you need, and it's not just playing the violin. You have to be resourceful. You have to be very adaptable. You cannot be fazed by the unknown, come what may, at 7:30 or even 3 o'clock in the afternoon. You are on stage. If you can't perform, then you have to wrap up and go home and not try again, because it is a lot more about just being able to focus yourself when that moment arrives. So what else? Still on Mazur, I think we'll have a little bit more music. A piece of music that's very meaningful to me, and I know Hugh is very, very pleased about this. I would like to play one of the marvellous Strauss four last songs. And this performance is Jesse Norman, conducted by Kurt Mazur with the Leipzig Gewandhaus Orchestra.
Thank you.
Oh, such a beautiful piece of music, isn't that? Absolutely heavenly. And I love the spaciousness of this version of the four last songs. It's a very special piece of music and a very special recording for me. Talking of recordings. So, things were progressing nicely, but perhaps a little slowly at the end of the 80s when I began my career. But in 1990, two very major things happened to me. The first was that I was invited to make my debut at the BBC Proms, and this served to elevate me a few rungs up the level of where you might be as a solo artist, and that was very exciting. And I went on to give 10 consecutive proms and two last nights of the proms, and by the time I stepped down from the concert platform, I'd given 20 or 21 proms in total in the whole span of my career. So the proms was a very, very important venue and a very, very important audience, which I'll never, ever forget. But the second exciting thing that happened to me in 1990 was that a wonderful lady called Trish Byrne invited me to make my first recording for EMI. And this was a defining moment, the beginning of my recording career. And by the time I finished my recording career, I made 45 commercial recordings. So my discography ended up being very extensive. But it all began in 1990 with the release of this first recording, the Bruch and the Dvorak Concertos. It was very well received. And I went on then to make lots more recordings for EMI, one of which we'll be hearing in a short while. But yes, that was very exciting. And then suddenly my career really began to take off. And also the other thing that happened was that people were starting to write pieces of music for me. So I was doing a lot of premieres, and then I began to really begin touring all over the world to some terrific places. Again, I played concerts in every continent of the world, every habitable continent. I didn't play in Antarctica, but not a good audience there, I'm told. Anyway, one of the special places that I did play was I gave 1997, and I made my New York Philharmonic Orchestra debut playing four performances of the Tchaikovsky Concerto. Guess who was in the audience for one of them? None other than Chaim Topol, who, of course, was Tevier in Fiddler on the Roof. So it was very special to have him there, and he was very proud. I was really, really excited that he was there. And I really had an opportunity to play with some incredible conductors. The list is long, but some of the most famous names were Simon Rattle, and I gave many, many performances with him, both in with the CBSO, but also with the Berlin Philharmonic when he took over as chief artist, as chief conductor and artistic advisor. He chose me as his soloist for his very first tour, which meant I got to play in Carnegie Hall and the Salzburg Festival and the Philharmonie in Berlin, and a whole raft of amazing concert halls. So that was very exciting. But another incredible person that I worked with was Gustavo Dudamel, who is probably the most exciting conductor who I've ever worked with. He is pure energy and pure charisma. Again, we did Tchaikovsky together, which was an absolute blast. So that was very exciting. But in addition to working with amazing conductors, really one of the best and most exciting parts of my career was always to collaborate with my concert pianists, every one of whom was a marvelous soloist in his own right. The first person that I met on my 21st birthday was Piers Lane, and at the end we'll have a recording of him and me. But the other person that I met early on in my career was Martin Roscoe. We were sort of match made musically by the composer George Lloyd, who only liked two pianists in the world, Catherine Stott and Martin Roscoe, and he only liked one violinist in the world, and that was me. So he asked if Martin and I would record his sonatas, which we did, and it was the start of a very enjoyable and long-standing collaboration for nearly 30 years with Martin. Piers and I played together for 33 years. One of the things I love about Martin's playing is the great character. He has a fantastic sense of humour, and he's just got such verve and character, and it was a pleasure to record all of the Beethoven piano and violin sonatas as the box set. That's one of those mountains that violinists want to climb, and I climbed it with Martin. And so I'd like to play you just a tiny little track from the famous Spring Sonata. This is the Scherzo, which is Beethoven's marvellous musical joke against violinists, because try as we might, we cannot catch up with the pianist. Such a funny piece, that, isn't it? In 2007, by this time I'd been working professionally for many years, and my career was going very well indeed. But one thing began to be a source of great frustration for me, and that was that music was still, classical music was still considered this slightly inaccessible part of our culture. And I determined to try to do something about it. I'd given numerous interviews and particularly still very, very concerned about education in this country for music. It used to be, you know, really a high, strong part of the national curriculum, which is why I was able to start it at state primary school. But I fear that our position is not what it once was. And the net result of that, of course, is that there are great swathes of people in this country and elsewhere who just feel that classical music isn't for them, even though they don't necessarily know anything about it. But there's just this idea of what classical music must be. And generally, of course, it is something to do with this music must be very old, probably written in the 18th century. And so I began to have this idea for a project. And I decided I was going to record three different pieces of music. And I was going to put them, release them on the internet only and entirely free of charge. And so the three pieces of music were Bach, the full partita in E major, a modern piece by Paul Patterson called Luslowitzer Variations, and a piece written in the 1920s by the Belgian composer Eugène Ysaÿe. which is a fantastically virtuosic piece, very, very exciting. So three very different styles of classical music. I wrote spoken introductions, which I recorded to accompany each of these pieces of music so that people who didn't know anything about them would have my spoken introduction. I demonstrated the two violins that I had the use of. One was a Stradivarius made in 1708, the Regent, and my own violin, Guadagnini, made in 1757, the year after Mozart was born. So anyway, I released this, so I became the first person, the first artist, classical, pop, or any genre, to release an album online and totally free of charge. I couldn't have guessed how global it went. I mean, there were just literally thousands and thousands and thousands of downloads. And within, I think, the first couple of weeks, we had 250,000 downloads, and that rapidly went to 500,000. And letters from all over the world poured in, which was heartening and very, very individual letters as well. I had one from a man in China who wrote saying, "Dear Miss Little, you cannot imagine what this download has meant, because in China it's very difficult for us to buy CDs because many people don't have credit cards." And so that's obviously why there's a lot of stuff on the black market and bootlegging and all of this sort of thing. Anyway, he said to have a quality recording like this is just amazing. And honestly, I was in tears reading his very, very moving email. And then there was a five-year-old boy in America who wrote to say, "Dear Tasmin, I like your CD. It's good. I like Bach. Bach is good, but Patterson is gooder. Patterson is way gooder than Bach. Patterson is bzzz." And all of these amazing words. Anyway, it was absolutely adorable. I replied to everybody, absolutely everybody, which was a mammoth task. But I felt if people had been bothered to write to me, then they should have a response. So it was a really, really huge project. And then I started to go into the community. And I did a great, great many performances to people really within the community. I went into a lot of centres for people with communication disabilities, the National Centre for Epilepsy, a lot of prisons, and umpteen schools, really numerous schools. But one of the most moving experiences I had, I played in Belmarsh, and oh yes, the South Bank show, the television programme, they followed me for 2 months as I went around the country playing in different places. And that was a programme that I thoroughly enjoyed making. But anyway, one of the most interesting experiences I had was in McGaffrey prison in Ireland, and it's a very, you know, there's a lot of terrorists in the prison, and they said, "Where do you want to play?" I said, "I will play wherever you feel I am needed." And they said, "Well, would you go to the hospital wing?" Because nobody ever goes to the hospital wing. And I said, "Yes, of course." So there were only about 8 people, and then the staff, including a wonderful Irish matron. And it was one of the toughest gigs I'd ever done, because normally when I did, you know, this, the Naked Violin Project, I would talk and people would ask questions, particularly children. They ask a lot of questions. I couldn't get anything out of this group of people. I was hoping that they would ask me questions, but nobody was asking me anything. And there was this guy in the front row, he was just like this for the whole time. And it was really quite disconcerting. And so I'd sort of gone through most of the things that I was thinking that I would play, and I was beginning to run out of things, because by that time you're normally expecting somebody to have got some communication going. So almost as a joke to myself, I said, "Please somebody ask me something, or I will be forced to play some Bartok." Well, you know that joke, but of course they didn't, so it felt very flat, but I laughed inwardly. And so anyway, I thought, well, if I play the slow movement from the solo sonata, that's 10 minutes worth, so that's all right. So that's what I did. But I introduced it and I said, "This piece is really about not very much at all, and absolutely nothing is going to happen." But you might want to close your eyes and imagine that it's nighttime and you're in a darkened wood, and maybe you'll hear a bird or an owl in the distance and the crunch of leaves as an animal pads gently over them, or the rustle of wind somewhere. So anyway, I played it. And the guy who had been like this, he raised himself up and he said, "That was absolutely beautiful." And I couldn't believe it, because Bartok, you know, I mean, it just goes to show you should never ever try and guess what people are going to like. You know, it's Mozart for babies. Yeah, sure, Mozart's for babies, but perhaps Paul Patterson's for babies. I mean, you never ever know what's going to float somebody's boat. And I think it's very important for musicians to remember that. Anyway, Matron, at the end of it, she said, "Ah, to be sure, I was away with the fairies." So she liked it as well. So anyway, it was a great hit. That Bartok went down very well at McGaffrey Prison. Anyway, I also went internationally with this project. I went to Australia, to New Zealand, well into the Maori community, United States, but another very moving place that I went was to China. And I went to visit various schools, a school for children of migrant workers. So this is for children whose parents have had to come into the city to build roads and infrastructure, but there's no provision for their children to have schooling. So this was a school for these children, and they'd never heard any form of live entertainment at all. I was working obviously through an interpreter, but they were absolutely transfixed. And that was a very, very special visit. I went with John Lenihan, and he and I have toured. I've toured with all of my pianists, and he and I went all over South America together and various places. But one thing that we did do together as well was we wrote a piece of music. It was based on themes from Tchaikovsky's Swan Lake. And he'd asked me whether I wanted to make a violin and piano arrangement of the theme. And I said, "Well, that's a great idea, but why stop with just the theme? Because there's loads of amazing themes in this." So we wrote this piece together and we had a lot of fun. And we started to tour the piece and everybody loved it. And then we started to get rather silly with it and put in bits of 1812 overture with canon effects down at the bottom of the piano and all sorts of things. But then EMI said, "Would you like to record it?" And I said, "Yes, please, I would love to record it." Now, for those of you who are familiar with the piano concerto and the violin concerto, we did get rid of the 1812. But little snippets of the violin and piano concerto do remain. So we're going to hear it now. Keep your ears open, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you enjoy our Tchaikovskyana written by John Lenihan and myself. A lot of fun, that, isn't it? Yeah, we had huge fun putting it together and always enjoyed playing it. Audiences always loved it, so yep, very, very happy with that. After the success of the Naked Violin project, I began a collaboration with Chandos Records. And in fact, I went to them because one recording that I had not made was of the Elgar Violin Concerto. I had a lot of approaches in my 20s, but I didn't feel I was ready for it. I felt I needed to live with the piece and really, let it develop inside me. Anyway, in 2009, I felt I was ready to do that and commit it to disc. And I made a recording that I'm very proud of to this day with Andrew Davis and the Royal Scottish National Orchestra. And it ended up winning a Classic Brit Award. So sometimes it's a good idea to be patient and wait for the right time rather than just dive in. But there is one person that I wish I had met earlier rather than later, and that is the great pianist Andre Gugnin, who I met in 2016 when I went to work for Sydney International Piano Competition, and the six semi-finalists were given the opportunity to collaborate with me on a sonata sort of their choice. I gave them six possibilities, and Andre got to the final, to the semi-finals, and we played the Beethoven Kreutzer sonata together. It exists somewhere on YouTube if you're interested in it. Anyway, it was literally actually, you know, these connections happen immediately. We just were completely in sync as musicians, and I went on to give some hugely enjoyable concerts with him, but sadly not enough, and I never made a recording with him. So that is the one sadness and the thing that I wish that I'd had a little bit longer with him for. One of the concerts that I did in late 2020, which was one of the final concerts that I gave, was with all four of my pianists partnering me at the South Bank Centre. So it was the most special, probably special, musical evening of my life with Piers, Martin, John and Andre all working individually with me. And it was live broadcast on Radio 3 at least, because I think there were only about 30 people allowed in the whole of the festival hall that seats 3,000. Anyway, that was life. But I think let's appreciate some of Andre's artistry. And this is him playing an etude by Blumenfeld. Ladies and gentlemen, he is only using his left hand. Listen to this.
Thank you.
Beautiful. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're coming to nearly the end, and in a moment I'll offer you an opportunity if there's anybody that's got any questions. A lot of people said, why did you stop? I absolutely loved playing the violin. I was so lucky with all the concerts, the people I worked with, the places I played. But playing the violin is 24/7, and it doesn't allow you an opportunity really for any other interests, and I have many. And so I decided that I was going to hang up my gowns. And somebody said to me a couple of days ago, you didn't retire. I said, no, I didn't retire. And he said, you should have used that word life change. And so from now on, I'm calling it a life change, because that's what it is. I still work. I make two programs a month for a non-profit organization. They're little mini documentaries. I broadcast a lot on radio. Radio 3 has just commissioned me to make five programs for them. I mentor, I teach, I addressed some business leaders, top CEOs the other day, talking to them about how to focus their message and how to put it across. I am now president of the Menu in School with Daniel Barenboim, so sort of come full circle with that. I'm an ambassador for many charities, help musicians, awards for young musicians, trees for I can't even remember what it's called now. That's fine. It's embarrassing, isn't it? But anyway, it's for the endangered Pernambuco wood, trees for music, and lots. So life is full and life is enjoyable, and I get to go to concerts nowadays as well, which I really love. So we'll end with the final piece of music. But so just before we do, has anybody got anything that they would like to ask? Any questions?
You're not going to record anything anymore, are you?
I'm not going to record anymore. I don't actually possess a violin anymore. I have actually, I have empty violin cases and no violin. But I love singing. I sing a lot and I occasionally play the piano. I used to play very well. No, I'm not going to record anymore.
Shame. Do you still play the violin?
No, I've just said I don't have a violin, so I don't play at...
Else.
No, I don't even borrow anybody else's. Well, I can't imagine what it would sound like now. I haven't played for nearly 2 years. I'd probably sound terrible. And that was the point. I didn't want to go downhill. I was at the top of my game, and I always said I would stop at the top of my game, which is what I did.
Well, as you said, you have a very full life
I
now,
do.
So
that's very true, thank you. Yes.
There you go, Angela.
Yes. Just to speak into me.
Hello.
a
very dear old friend of mine who was a violin teacher, she seemed to be more possessive and paranoid about her bow than she was about her violin. I wonder if you've got any comments to say about that.
Well, I'll have to keep them very brief because we're nearly over time. But a lot of people don't realise that the bow is just as important as the violin. Her bow might well have been more valuable than her violin. Bows can be extremely valuable. They also make a difference. So, for instance, I had a lovely sartori bow, and when I had the use of the Stradivarius, the sartori bow went very well with the Strad. But then when I had to give the Strad back and I was just using my instrument, the sartori didn't complement it as well. So I found a different bow, a Richaud, made in 1928, a French bow, and that worked beautifully. And I'm happy to say that the person who bought my violin also wanted to keep the bow with the violin. So they have remained together, which is great news.
Tasmin, when you were in your performing career, roughly how many hours a day did you have to put in to stay at the top of your game? Roughly.
Probably four. I mean, I could get away for a certain amount of time with two, but really, if I was building towards a big tour, and particularly if I was going on tour with something monumental like the Elgar Concerto, it's as much about stamina and knowing that you can stand up on stage for nearly 1 hour and play and play and play and play, and that requires building the muscles up.
And did you sort of have an hour at scales, or was there some...
No, I stopped doing scales, I'm happy to say. The only time The only time I ever did scales towards the end of my career was if I'd taken a very rare and short break over, say, Christmas or over the summer, and then the first thing, in order to warm up the sound, to warm up the instrument, to warm my muscles up, I would play some slow scales to get my intonation back. But other than that, I did a lot of slow practice, which is actually one of the things that you do with scales anyway. You know, it's to concentrate on the sound, it's to concentrate on the technicality of the bow being parallel to the bridge and all of that sort of stuff. So it is actually possible, but don't tell anybody I said it. It is possible to do it without scales. But the thing is, that's only because I did my scales for years, and the scales early on is all about making sure that when, for instance, Mozart writes a B major scale, you know exactly which fingering to do because you've been practicing scales for years.
Other questions?
So, having changed careers now, what's been the most enjoyable part of having a lot more free time?
I wouldn't say I have a lot more free time. I do have some more free time. I tell you, with one of the most enjoyable things is having the opportunity to go and hear other people's concerts. Because although I felt obviously very lucky to perform with great musicians, there were certain aspects where I felt culturally undernourished, and that I wanted to go more to the theatre and to the cinema and go to a gallery. And I didn't really have time to do any of those things. So I think it's that the cultural nourishment from elsewhere that I've been able to gain, as well as time, a little more time with friends and family. Mm-hmm. You have somebody over there.
Hello, Tasmin.
Hi.
I'm not sure if you've ever been on Desert Island Discs.
Twice.
So what was your luxury?
My luxury was an endless supply of good coffee.
No violin.
No violin. I have all the music I need in my head.
Hi, Tasmin. I've known you long enough. I should know the answer to this, but did you ever indulge in jazz?
Actually, a little
why
bit.
Why not?
Yeah, no, I did. I did a little bit with the great pianist and organist Wayne Marshall. And we put together some lovely arrangements of Gershwin and Cole Porter's songs. And I really, really enjoyed that. But it's the sort of thing you have to do regularly, because it requires quite a lot of nerve to just take yourself away from the music and just literally make stuff. And actually, it requires a lot of nerve to stand up on stage with Wayne, because you never know what he's going to do.
Any final question?
How did you approach music that you actually didn't like?
I am very happy to say that one of the perks of being a soloist, and a successful one, is that generally you don't have to play any music that you don't like. And I was offered the opportunity not just to play a particular violin concerto by a particularly well-known composer, but record it. And I stood to make some money out of it, and I said no. I said, it doesn't do anybody any good. I don't like the music, so I won't enjoy playing it. I don't think I'll make a good case for it because I won't be in sympathy with it, and you're better off to give the work to someone else.
Well, I think that's it, Tasmin.
Okay, lovely. Well, we have one more piece of music that I would like to play before we all say bye-bye. This is actually the final piece that I recorded. Literally, I did the final CD, which was the third in a series of three CDs of British violin sonatas and other works. So this one, which won a BBC Music Magazine award, ends with a lovely, charming piece by Eric Coates called First Meeting. Now, Piers Lane was the first pianist that I recorded with. He was my longest standing pianist, and I loved working with him. He's one of my best friends as well, just a super nice person. And we both felt quite moved doing this, knowing it was the last time that we would be recording anything together. And the piece ends with a terribly long goodbye from me. And so anyway, I thought it would be appropriate to end this afternoon with this, and that will be the end of this afternoon.
Thank you.
It was a masterly talk, Tasmin. It really was. It's a
Thank
privilege
you.
To be here.
Thank
and
you
know, the work and the work that goes into achieving what you've achieved in the classical music world, it's such a tough world out there. To achieve your eminence is quite something, and your modesty hides some of it, but it's a real privilege to hear a first-hand account of how it's done.
Thank you.
Some gorgeous music on the way. Absolutely wonderful. It's a shame we didn't see a video of that guy playing us on his left hand.
You'll find it.
You have to be a pianist to know how hard
it's
that is.
It's on YouTube. Look
it's
it up. André Guglin Blumenfeld.
It is unbelievable. Mm, mm. And as for the four last songs, that had us in tears. And there was a wonderful afternoon. Of course, we regard Tasmin as one of ours. I've been a long-term Ealing resident, and I see a lot of people from Wimborne Crescent here, but so anyway, thank you so much for that, Tasmin. It's been a memorable afternoon, and a lot of people both here and in the wider world will have loved it. So a big round of applause.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks so much. Thank you. Thank you very much.
And if you've enjoyed it from afar, you might like to think of going to our PayPal facility and donating so we can keep all these concerts going. We have 120 concerts here a year, all streamed. The next one's on Tuesday, every Tuesday, Thursday and Sunday, so keep watching. Thank you very much for being with us. The technicians today, you've done a fabulous job. We have Rob Jenkins upstairs working the cameras, and George Auckland putting together all the excerpts, highly complicated. Thank you, George, for that, and Jill Rowley on box office. So thank you very much for being with us on a special afternoon. And with that, a very good afternoon from St. Mary's Perivale in West London. Thank you.